Welcome, everyone. We're here today to learn about multiple sclerosis, or MS. And with me, I have one of our neurologists, and I'm going to ask him to introduce himself.
Hey, I'm Sargon Bet-Shlimon. I'm a neurologist here, and I specialize in multiple sclerosis and neuroimmunology.
Let's start with our first question. What is multiple sclerosis?
Yeah, so multiple sclerosis, or MS for short, is a disease in which the immune system, which is normally fighting infections and other things like that, actually attacks the nervous system, and in particular, the central nervous system, which mainly comprised of the brain, spinal cord, and the optic nerves. And in particular, the immune system likes to attack this substance called myelin, which is basically an electrical sheathing around nerve cells, which helps them conduct signals. So that's what is attacked in MS, and that's why it's sometimes called a demyelinating disease.
What causes MS?
We don't. So we know that there are genetic and environmental factors at play. There's a lot of research about different things that can increase a patient's risk for MS, but we don't have an exact cause pinned down.
What are the signs and symptoms of MS?
Yeah, so the signs and symptoms can really vary. And the reason is that a lot of symptoms in MS come from specific areas of the nervous system being damaged. And so if there is one particular area that's being damaged during part of someone's course, then they might have one symptom, whereas if a different part of the nervous system is being damaged, they could have a totally different symptom. And those kind of symptoms can exist in the same person. Different people might also have different manifestations. And oftentimes these symptoms, after they come on, they'll often improve, especially early on when someone has the disease. And so that's why it can often be difficult to make a diagnosis, especially if things get better, they're attributed to something else. And sometimes it takes a few instances of symptoms before someone has, someone puts together the pieces and realizes that this is a neurologic disease. But broadly, you can have symptoms ranging from vision changes to changes in sensation or walking and balance, even changes in bladder or bowel function.
How do you diagnose MS?
So we don't have any one specific test to diagnose MS, unfortunately. And so what we do is we use a set of diagnostic criteria, which take into account someone's symptoms, their neurologic examination findings, imaging findings from MRI, and even lab findings. And so if someone meets those criteria, then as long as we don't have some other explanation for their symptoms, then they could get a diagnosis of MS. That other explanation of symptoms means that we also often have to look for other things and exclude other causes of symptoms before we attribute them to MS.
How is MS treated? Is there a cure?
Unfortunately, I wish there was a cure, but there is no cure. And so it's a chronic illness that people carry with them throughout the duration of their lives. That being said, we do have treatments, and a lot of the treatment of MS focuses around preventative treatment, so taking medications that reduce the risk of damage to the nervous system and ultimately reduce the risk of accumulating disability down the line.
I've heard MS is more prevalent in the Pacific Northwest. Why is that?
Yeah, that's definitely something that people have noticed, is that MS is more prevalent not just in the Pacific Northwest, but other areas at high latitudes. And there's some theories about this. One thing that may factor in is sunlight exposure and vitamin D levels. There's some evidence that draws an association between low vitamin D levels and risk of developing MS or risk of worsening MS. And then the other factor that may be playing into that is people's genetic background. So MS tends to be more prevalent in people of Northern European descent, and we have a lot of those type of folks here in the Northwest.
If someone has MS, how will it impact their life?
You know, it's really hard to say because it can be variable from person to person. So Some patients might go their entire lives with very few symptoms or have kind of minimal impact of the disease. Other patients might be more severely impacted. So it really is hard to say from one individual to another, but what we do know is that being on these preventative medications for MS will reduce the risk of disability later on and improve chances that people will have less impact as they go on in their life.
What is an MS flare? How long does it last?
So an MS flare, which also goes by a handful of other names that all mean the same thing, exacerbation, relapse, attack. What that is when the immune system attacks a particular part of the nervous system and produces symptoms that are referable to that part of the nervous system, depending on what that part does. So for example, if someone has an attack that involves the nerve behind the right eye, they might have blurriness and pain when they move the eye. So that would be an attack in the eye. But if, for example, they had an attack in the spinal cord, they might have, say, changes in sensation from some part of their body downward. So the attack basically reflects an area of damage that is going on in one particular part of the nervous system that is causing symptoms. And if we're going by a strict definition, then the duration has to be at least 24 hours. But that being said, realistically, these attacks are usually much longer. So usually symptoms will come on over a day or a few days. They will usually last for days to weeks at a time. And then they'll usually slowly improve after that to variable degrees of improvement, depending on the attack and depending on the person.
What lifestyle changes should you make if you're diagnosed with MS?
So people often ask about lifestyle changes in MS, and there's a few things that we know, but there's a lot of things that we don't know. So one thing that is very, very clear is that if you are a smoker, you should stop smoking, not only for your general health, but we do know that people who smoke tend to have worse MS over time compared to people who don't. In terms of things like diet and exercise, there's been a lot of diets that have been tested or proposed in MS, but there's nothing that's been proven to be beneficial. No one diet has been proven to be helpful more than another. So what I often recommend to my patients is eating a diet that is heart healthy, basically, and one of the ones that has been best studied in that context is the Mediterranean diet. It's high in polyunsaturated fats, low in saturated fats, high in fibers, lean proteins, things like that. And the reason for that is, again, not only your general health, but we do know that people who have uncontrolled cardiovascular disease also tend to have worse MS with time. So in that same vein, keeping up a good regular exercise schedule is also a good idea. The last one that might be a good idea, and this should be in consultation with your doctor, would be vitamin D supplementation. People often have low or low normal vitamin D levels that need to be supplemented, but again, that's something that should probably be discussed with the doctor.
If your friend or family member has MS, how can you support them?
Yeah. This is a chronic illness that has a lot of ups and downs, and so I think just being aware of the fact that people do have times when they're going to be more affected, times when they're going to be less impacted, and being able to be emotionally there for them and supportive of them through those times is probably the best thing that you can do as a friend or family member of someone with MS.
Thank you, Dr. Bet-Shlimon. We appreciate you answering our questions. And for those of you who are watching, you're welcome to go to our website to learn more. Thank you.